In London, buried underground, lies a dark root that's been in use for over 175 years. Begun as a project to transform the capital, it would spark a subterranean revolution.
Walking through these quite typical London streets, it's easy to miss the fact that this is the site of one of the most innovative and impactful projects of the 19th century.
The creation of this tunnel was thought impossible by many.
The structure's the first of its kind. It's never been done before.
It's important in its own right, but even more so is how it still informs modern engineering projects. The technique adopted remains the way we do tunnels today.
But they had no idea the impact it would have on the rest of the world. It was extremely clever and innovative, but also very ambitious for its time.
Beneath the streets of East London is one of the oldest sections of the city's many underground rail lines. But this stretch has a greater claim to fame.
It's used by commuters every single day, and it runs from Wapping on the North Bank to Rotherhithe on the South Bank. But actually, it is a unique part of history.
People riding the train, commuting daily, wouldn't realize that underneath is something truly remarkable.
As the trains pass through, the tunnel seems pretty standard. But what's special about it is the location and how it was built.
What was done here had been attempted by others before, but this was the first successful attempt.
This is the Thames Tunnel, the first tunnel to be dug underneath a river.
So at the beginning of the 19th century, London was probably the busiest port in the world, and there was a lot of commercial activity. But to actually physically take items from, say, Wapping to Rotherhithe, you had to go through some of the most congested streets in London.
Tunnelling below a navigable river had never been achieved before. Here, it would take almost two decades and claim at least six lives in the process.
This project was mammoth in scale and far greater than anything anyone could have anticipated.
The final structure lies beneath the 300-metre-wide River Thames. And incredibly, at their closest, the riverbed and the tunnel roof are just 4 metres apart. Today, Wapping Station resides in the old Northern Access Chamber. But on the other side lies a similar structure, and this one marks a key moment in history.
With the tunnel still in use, it's hard to get close to it, but there is an area that still exists almost as it was. This is the site where Marc Brunel began his pioneering Thames Tunnel.
Brunel and his team got underway here in 1825, and both the location and design of this structure were vital to ensuring a successful start.
Is that the sound of trains underneath us?
It absolutely is, yeah. The London Overground, going between Wapping and Rotherhithe Station.
So what is this space?
So we're standing 16 metres underground in a tunnelling shaft. It was built by constructing a 25-tonne iron hoop and then covering that with bricks to make this cylindrical structure that you can see around us.
This area here is the bricks that they were putting on top of the ring.
Exactly. And what was really clever about Marc Brunel's idea is that he used the weight of the shaft itself to sink directly into the riverbed. So think of it like an enormous pastry cutter going into the riverbed.
When deep enough, this shaft would provide access for the workers and equipment. Once they'd reached a depth of around 25 metres, then the tunnelling under the river would begin.
It looks like such a simple structure, but this really was a genius mind at work because the engineer understood the disadvantages of the surrounding soil, but embraced it to create something truly epic.
The greatest challenges and dangers, however, still lay ahead.
The idea of tunnelling under the Thames wasn't new. In 1807, Cornish miners attempted to actually construct a tunnel, and they did get reasonably far before the sewage-ridden waters of the Thames flooded the tunnel and the whole project died a death. So the idea was abandoned. Indeed, most people didn't think it would be possible.
But Brunel believed otherwise. He'd come up with a plan to overcome the risk of a cave-in, and his inspiration came from an unlikely source.
Based on an entry in Mark Brunel's own diary, he observed a piece of ship lumber, and on it he saw a worm digesting the wood and excreting it. And in this excretion, it was forming a lining. And this was the idea that sparked the thinking for his own tunnel shield.
The tunneling shield was a relatively simple idea, but it revolutionized what was possible. An iron frame, 12 cells across and 3 cells tall.
The key thing underpinning Mark Brunel's tunneling shield is that the roof and the sides of the tunnel wouldn't collapse. You have an iron frame and in front wooden slats with a number of compartments where workers would dig into the tunnel.
Outside the tunnel shaft is a model of 2 such compartments.
So how exactly does this contraption work?
One of the miners would be inside each of these cells. They'd basically be at the tunnel face.
It's tiny. Standing here gives you a real sense of just how small and cramped the space was for the workers. So they were chipping away at this end. Like, how fast were they going?
Not very fast at all. They're doing all of this with hand tools. It's really painstaking, back-breaking work. So they're only really moving, a couple of inches at a time.
You'd remove one of the wooden slats, dig about 9 inches, about the size of an average brick, then you put the wooden slat back. And when all of this had been completed, you'd move the tunnel shield in 2 parts. And then behind, you'd have men at the back, who were brickies, laying the roof above to make sure it didn't collapse.
It was this invention that made digging the Thames Tunnel possible. And it's why this site remains one of the most important engineering achievements in the world.
It must have been really ingenious for its time.
Absolutely. Mark Brunel was the first person to come up with the idea of the tunnelling shield, but his ideas are still being used today to build tunnels. If he went to any of the tunnelling projects that were happening today, he would recognise his technology.
With almost 200 years having passed since Brunel began this tunnel, his innovation has spread across the world and received a number of upgrades. But modern tunnelling projects still rely on the core idea, as can be seen at a site on the other side of the world, in Australia.